This program is brought to you by NewsWorks in cooperation with the City of Eau Claire. This program is simulcast on WRFP LP 101.9 FM.
Good evening. It's 7 o'clock, so I'll call the June meeting of the Waterways and Parks Commission to order. First item of agenda is approval of the minutes from the April 25th meeting. There are no minutes from the May 23rd because there was not a quorum in order to have a meeting. So, is there a motion to approve the minutes from April? A second? Ron and Tom? All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Okay, new business for today. First item is the appointment of a new commission member, Kirk Dahl. Welcome. To the commission. If you would like to say a little bit about yourself and how you came to join the commission.
Yeah, thank you. First of all, it's an honor to be here. I had a chance to meet a few of you already, but some of you I knew from before, but I'm honored to be on the commission. I'm from Minneapolis. I came over here as a physician at Sacred Heart. I was in the emergency room there for 29 years. I was medical director of the ER for 22 of those years. And early on, I bought some land in town. And, my backup plan, had I not been a physician, was along the lines of earth science. So I have a lot of interest in environmental things and geology and geography and all that kind of stuff. I did end up serving a term on the County Parks and Forest Committee. And that just expired here this past May. And I put in paperwork to be on either the Sustainability Committee for City of Eau Claire or this committee, and I ended up being selected here. My only other official connection to the city is I do have a contract with the city to oversee the 911 system, the medical aspects of the 911 system. And otherwise, I'm just a citizen. So, thank you.
Thank you, and welcome to the commission.
Thank you.
Second item of new business is an updated photo of the commission, but logistically we'll do that at the end, so we'll move that after item six. Moving on to other new business is the recommendation on sign plan and conditional use permits pertaining to signs and building illumination for the Pablo Performing Arts Building. Pat?
Okay. The Confluence Council Incorporated has submitted an application for a master sign plan for the Pablo Performing Arts Center. It's located at 128 Graham Avenue. This is the location of the project here, with the Chippewa River, Eau Claire River, Haymarket Plaza that's being developed right now, just to the north right now. The application also includes approval of a couple of conditional use permits that I'll explain in a few minutes here. The sign plan is a requirement of the original approval of the building site plan that was approved a couple years ago. As I mentioned, the parcel abuts the Chippewa River and Haymarket Plaza. Therefore, the recommendation from the Waterways and Parks Commission is required. This will go on to the Plan Commission, who actually will make the final decision on the sign plan and the conditional use permits. Included in your packet is a narrative from the applicant that discusses the proposed signage and the building illumination. I have a few slides and things like that that will further explain that. The signs that are part of the sign plan include four signs with the word Pablo on it. One is on the north elevation facing Haymarket Plaza. That would be about 53 square feet in size. One would be on the south elevation along Gibson Street. It would be smaller, about 26 square feet. There would be one on the east side of the building, up near the top roof. It would be larger. That would be 250 square feet in size. And then one on the west wall. That would be facing the Chippewa River. That also would be 250 square feet in size. And again, I'll show you some illustrations of these signs when I finish here. In addition, there's a proposed electronic message center sign that would face Graham Avenue. We don't have specific information on that for you tonight because since it faces Graham Avenue, it really is not an issue related to the Chippewa River or the Haymarket Plaza. but a message center sign basically is an electronic type of display where they can change their messages periodically to talk about what's going on at the particular center. There also will be a banner will be periodically displayed on the north elevation of the building advertising some of the events. And then there'll be some banners that'll include some artwork on the north side. Again, I'll show you some pictures of those too. The conditional use permit is required for the proposed signs that are on the east and the west walls that exceed 100 square feet. The criteria for the review by the Planning Commission, we included in your staff report. I won't go through that in detail. But basically what the criteria does, it looks at in terms of the scale and compatibility of the building in terms of whether that size seems to fit that particular building. Normally in the downtown area, 100 square feet is the maximum, but with this conditional use permit, they can go, can request a larger sign. In addition, the sign plan proposes that the illumination of the building and that the four Pablo signs would be allowed to change in brightness and color over time. This would be similar to the lighting changes that have been approved for the Phoenix Park Bridge. Also for the new pedestrian bridge that will be going across from Haymarket Plaza over to Phoenix Park. And then also the lighting that we're putting in on the Grand Avenue Bridge. So it would be similar, and the applicants can kind of talk about that a little bit more. This also is allowed through the conditional use process. And again, the review criteria from the Planning Commission, we included that in your packet, but I won't go through that in detail. But again, basically looking at compatibility in terms of how it fits into the downtown environment. And again, with being this a performing arts center, you want to have a building that has some active appeal and some vitality to it. Finally, the review criteria is also contained in our city's Greenway guidelines. We included that in the staff report. Basically, just in the summary, it states that wall signs facing the waterway should be subdued and not have direct illumination. The design and location of all signs should complement the design of the development and preserve the scenic quality of the area. So that's one of the criteria that we'd be looking at. The proposed signs would be lighted with interior illumination. They would not be directly illuminated. What that means is where you actually see the bulbs, the actual light bulb itself. There actually is a film in front of that, so you're not actually seeing the light bulbs themselves. The Waterways and Parks Commission should review should primarily focus on the signs that face the Chippewa River and Haymarket Plaza. So that would be the west elevation and the north elevation. And then the proposed variation in the building illumination and color for the Pablo signs that are visible from the river and from the Haymarket Plaza. As I mentioned, this will be reviewed by the Planning Commission. This will go to them on July 16th. And with that, I'll show you a few illustrations that were included in the packet. Again, this is the site that we're looking at right here. This is the sign package that this is the first sign that would be on the north elevation. It's about 55 square feet in size. Again, it would be lighted. And let's see here. This shows the north elevation of the building. The actual sign location would be right here where I have the cursor here. And I will show some more specifics of that later. This is an artist rendering of where the sign would sit. It would sit on top of the canopy, the entrance canopy on the north side. And then this is a night view of what the sign would look like. This is a sign that would be on the south elevation by Gibson Street. Again, same design, but about half the size. This is the south elevation. And the sign would be located right in this area right here. Gibson Street is right along, Grand Avenue is located right along here. And then this would be, again, the kind of the artist rendering of it. These are the two larger signs now. This would be on the east elevation. This sign is about 250 square feet in size. Here's the east elevation. You can see it would the up near the roof line, up, and this is, I think, up about four stories, basically, about what the height of that would be. And then this would be a view of, in terms of how it would look in the daytime, right here, and then this would be a night view of it located here. This picture here would be taken looking basically on Graham, the corner of Graham Avenue and Eau Claire Street, pretty much looking towards the southwest. This is the same side that would be on the west elevation, so this would be the one that would be facing the river. So this is the river elevation, and again, it would be up near the roof line in this area here, again, about the fourth floor or so. So this would be visible, both sides will be visible for a fairly good distance. And this is how it would look in the daylight, and this is the nighttime view of it here. So that's the sign package. And then I did make reference to banners that would be used. This is the north elevation of the building. So this is basically the front entrance of the building. This is the canopy area here, and the Pablo sign would be located in this area here. This, they'll have one banner that will be about 100 square feet in size that they'll size and they'll install periodically that will advertise events, things going on at the center. So this will be changed periodically. And then they also will have a couple banners over towards the right side. And these basically would be basically just kind of artistic types of things that would not have any specific signage or anything like that. And the reason for this, there are limits based on our sign code in terms of how many banners for signage that would be allowed for a building. So this would be allowed as long as they use this for art or decoration types of things, and that's perfectly fine too. And then this is just kind of a close-up of kind of what would be envisioned for that. There's a couple photos that were taken. This is taken along Graham Avenue here, and then this is Gibson. So the one Pablo sign would be located right in this area here, right above this doorway here. These referred to in the narrative, these are the pixie sticks that were referred to, and they'll be 9-inch globes that will be located at the top of these pixie sticks, and those would be those globes would be part of the lighting that could alternate in terms of going from different colors and things like that. Just looking a little further down Graham Avenue. And then again, Graham Avenue looking back the other way. So the entrance to the facilities over in this location here. Here's some additional pixie sticks located here. Again, the globes are not installed, but they would be at the top here. There also, they talked about some building illumination. And I think they referred to some 4- and 8-inch tubes. And I'm under the understanding that these are probably those light tubes, okay, that will be on the building. And then those would be changing colors periodically, too. And again, the applicants kind of talk about this in a little more detail in terms of how that is going to be programmed. Again, a little bit closer, again, showing where those would be. Again, the Pablo sign would be located right on top of the canopy here. Some more pixie sticks located here and then back in this area here. So again, where there would be globes on top of that in this area here. And again, the building lighting with these tubes that would be on the black brick portion. And then just a little bit of a close-up showing kind of what that looks like. Again, a little bit of a close-up. This is across the river, looking back south at the north elevation. Again, these would be some of those tubes that would be providing some of the accent lighting. There would be a banner located here. Some of the other banners would be located in this area. Again, some pixie sticks over in this area here. And then just a little bit of a close-up there. some of those light tubes that would be on the side of the building. This would be on the north elevation, I think. And then this just shows, this would be, looking again back at the river, this would be the wall, that one large Pablo sign would be on it. So that would be the east elevation located here. That's all I have for those. And then this is a photograph of the east elevation of the building. So Graham Avenue is located here, Gibson Street's here. Our new park, Haymarket Plaza, will be located here. So that Pablo sign will be located right up in this area, right up in here, on the east elevation. The message center that I referred to, more than likely, we had not actually seen plans for that yet, but more than likely that will be down in this area right here. Something about right? And then this would be the west elevation. This is the elevation facing the Chippewa River. So the other larger Pablo sign will be located right up in this area right here, with the Chippewa River and Haymarket Plaza located here. That pretty much covers my overview and review of the proposal. If you have any questions of me, otherwise Julia and Dan are here to answer questions also.
Any questions for Pat?
Can you show and point out in your photographs, from the actual photographs, can you show where the north-facing Pablo sign is going to go?
Yeah.
I think it's right above that copper.
Yeah, it'd be right in.
But where?
Right in this area right here. I think it would be on the roof of the canopy, basically.
But when you look at it at night, will it be in front of the windows?
You can ask Dan or Julia when we get to that. I'm not. Actually, let me go back. There is one.
Oh, it's home here, for example.
So it's in front of the wall.
Yeah, that's the.
Okay.
Yeah,
there it is.
It's mounted on the canopy, so it's not actually mounted. It's freestanding on the canopy in front of that wall.
But you wouldn't be trying to read it while it was in front of windows that would have lights on, because
no,
it
no.
would be in front of the wall itself.
Correct.
Okay. Thank you.
Any other questions?
Those pixie sticks, they're only illuminated at the top. The sticks themselves are not.
That's my understanding. Yep.
Jason?
Are the light displays on the three bridges and this building going to be coordinated at all?
We'll have to ask Dan that. Dan and Julia. So why don't we finish with my questions and then we'll have them discuss.
Kate?
We've heard some concerns before about light pollution and sort of lighting standards for fish species and for migratory birds and that sort of thing. Do we have any sort of standards, has that kind of been considered at all in these signs?
When we look at the site plan and permits for lighting for buildings, we do look at dark sky compliant types of lighting in terms of making sure that the lighting is shielded. In terms of the pixie sticks, I guess we'll have to ask the applicant in terms of the brightness of those, because that's a little bit different type of a lighting. But otherwise, the building itself, the lighting will all have shielded lighting on it. That was part of the review of the site plan that we looked at back a couple of years ago.
If I could follow up.
Sure.
Does the city or even the state or the beds have any, does a standard like that exist for a city project like this?
Well, in terms of the lighting of the building itself, we do, in terms of the dark sky compliant.
Okay.
I was based on what I read from the description of the project. I'm envisioning lighting that's similar to what we're seeing on the Phoenix Park Bridge. So I don't think we're talking about any lighting that's really intensely bright. But I guess we can find that out.
Okay.
I've heard complaints about the building right next door, the Haymarket Landing building, being too bright. From the astronomy club that likes to set up their telescopes just across the river in Phoenix Park. And I don't know if the same standards are being applied or if standards have gotten stricter since then.
We've heard those complaints too, and I think our inspection department has been working on trying to correct that.
Any other questions for Pat? If not, the applicants wish to address the commission.
So there are no shortage of stakeholders there.
There's the podium in front. If you like to come here,
sorry.
And also, if you wouldn't mind just stating your names for the record, please.
Hi, I'm Julia Johnson. Thank you, Pat, for presenting
my project. Dan Plotner. And I'm here as a agent for the owner, Eau Claire Arts, Inc., and as a member of the Confluence Council, the operator. Julia is a member of Arts, Inc., and also part of the Pablo group, who have been very influential in the building concepts and branding and all of those things. So I think the first thing, and probably the overall, the biggest question I think everybody has is about the nature of illumination. And the context of the pixie sticks, of the Veya tubes, and all the signage is that think more of glow sticks than flashlights. It's all designed to be very subtle. And if they're not conflicting terms, it's readable, but subtle. And again, but think in terms of the glow and not the emission of a lot of light. The fixture on top of the pixie sticks is about a 9-inch globe, and it, again, it's glows, it doesn't necessarily light. The same with the head tubes, they're tubes that glow. Both of those have capacity to change colors in concert with all of the color changes that are going around. So the bridge, the pedestrian bridge, and more in the future, hopefully, down at Grand Avenue and thereabouts. The concept generally is that the stakeholders here have attempted to really respect not only the requirements of the city, but also I think the intent and the themes that you've endorsed and to some extent embraced in the past. The expansion of the Phoenix Park and to the plaza and points beyond, we think is very congruous with the park planning. And on the waterfront, we've done everything we can to appropriately use the waterfront and expose both access and utilization to the waterfront by the way that the improvements have been structured. So that's, from the broad perspective, it's really an attempt to respect all of the provisions of the planning efforts that have come before us and those that we've seen since. And if we've missed any of that, we welcome opportunity to discuss that. The other couple of things, the building, the sign on the west side, the one Pablo sign that faces the Chippewa River, is actually about the height of the Lismore. It's three stories of our building, but it's really about 8 or 9 stories high. So that's really an elevated sign. Hence, the scale is fairly important. But again, the intent is to be reasonable, not glaring. The other signs that we talked about, again, those beta tubes and pixie sticks only apply to the north, to the plaza side, and a little bit around to the northeast, where the entrance kind of wraps around into that first section. They're not anywhere on the west or south or most of the east side of the building. So I think from a global perspective, I don't know that we have anything, but if you, Julie's got all kinds of really good answers for any of your more specific questions or more of their intent and their vision.
Well, I think I'd like to add is that, yes, the lights are controlled by the same master brain that the lights on the Phoenixburg Bridge and the other applications. So they all talk back to this main controller so they can be programmed together, and they vary in color and intensity. So at any point, you could imagine that they are on a dimmer. So if it were problematic, or if you say you want it at 50% from 7 p.m. to 9 p.m., and then it really needs to dip down to 30%, so it's a nightlight rather than a kitchen light, it has that capability.
That's the sign as well as the globes and tubes. Mm-hmm. Okay, great.
Jason,
what's the significance of the name Pablo?
Pablo Properties chose the name Pablo because it is a favorite record producer from Zach Olmsted's favorite jazz musician.
Yeah, plenty obscure.
Susan?
I have a couple kind of questions or remarks. First of all, I really like the logo style. I think it has a nice arty style, but it's not real complicated. It's not gonna get in the way. I think it shows up really nicely on those solid walls. I was a little curious, though, why none of the signs, unless there's some other signage, actually say what Pablo is, like, or that it's a performing arts center, or it's an art center, or it's a center. I've seen it different ways. And I remember in the early days of ECRAC that different people had different interpretations for what it was, sometimes the same person in the same conversation, whether it was a center or a council or whatever. So was that a conscious decision to not do that? Could you talk a little bit about that, please?
The naming of the building was a very conscious decision, wanting to keep confluence in the name, made it very difficult to keep a lot more other words in the name. So at the confluence was chosen over Pablo Arts Center at the confluence. That's more like a sentence, and we were worried that at some point it would become an acronym that people understand even less than Pablo Center or Pablo Center at the confluence. And by the for this specifically, the signage being Pablo rather than keeping the tagline Center at the confluence was just on scalability. By the time you make Pablo large enough to be legible, the Center at the confluence almost looks like just an underline underneath. So by the time you get to the door and you're pulling it, there it would say Pablo Center at the confluence, but from these far off visions, or you're meant to see the 13.5-foot Pablo sign up 6 stories from a long distance away. So you get more detail as you get closer.
Okay, thanks.
Are there any other questions? Okay, Julia.
Thank you very much.
Is there any discussion on the matter?
I suppose an analogy is like the Lismore. It doesn't say the Lismore Hotel with restaurants and coffee shop. It just says the Lismore, and then you know what it is.
If there's no further discussion, the motion is for the recommendation on the sign plan and conditional use permits. If there's no further discussion, is there a motion to approve the plan as submitted?
So moved.
Jason, is there a second? Jenny? Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Okay, the plan is recommended. Thank you. Next item on the agenda is the 2018 special events list.
Well, needless to say, we've been having several special events in the city. All you have to do is come down on a weekend night and you'll see everything going on. But a little bit of what's going on this coming weekend, we got the Doll and Pet Parade on First Avenue and Home Park. Again, that's a repeat event. It's been going on for several years. I forget how many years they're celebrating.
71st, I think.
What was it?
I think it's 71st.
Yeah. So,
wow.
I mean, been very popular, certainly. I bring my dog down there, but he's getting a little slow, and probably slow.
My son's going to dress up as a Hodak.
We also have Family Day in downtown, happening again on Saturday. That's in Phoenix Park. That's a repeat of event that goes on, and it's been very popular. So, and then coming next Wednesday on July 4th, we got the July 4th celebration at Carson Park. So several activities going on that day. We've got the American Legion Baseball starting out during the late morning, afternoon, followed by the Express game. We do have a football game, although the Predators aren't playing this year. We do have the I think they're called the Stanley Cowboys, and they'll be playing a team from St. Paul. So, and then new, we will have during the early or late morning, early afternoon, we're going to have a soccer expedition going on the football field. So that will be going on earlier in the day. So we do expect we have 15,000, and that probably will be pretty close anchor, because anytime we have July 4th during the middle part of the week, the attendance is much higher than if it is on the weekend.
People are out of town.
More apt to stay home to enjoy the fireworks. So, coming up on the 5th of July, we got the Oxbow Street concert going on Galloway Street over by the Oxbow in between Dewey and Farrell Street, so that'll be happening. Again, that's a repeat event that happened last year, so success, they're bringing it back. And then following that, from the July 5th to the 7th, we got stand-up paddleboard yoga going on at the Half Moon Beach, so there's an opportunity that is, if you're interested in that, they certainly, that's something that's being put on by yoga instructor that does it on a paddleboard, so it's going to happen on Half Moon Beach.
You say it's in on the beach, but
it's
assuming it's in the water.
It's in the water.
It'd be easier.
Yeah, so I think I could come up if it's on the beach, but maybe not in the water.
Well, if you're a little unsteady, you might want to keep the paddleboard on the beach.
So I urge you one or the other,
yeah,
right. Not both.
And then that same weekend, from the 7th, July 7th, or 6th through the 8th, we got the Taylor Ann Thompson Memorial Softball Tournament. It's a 40-team tournament that will be happening in Carson Park on the line in Hobbs Field. Part of the proceeds go back to the St. Jude's Children Research for Cancer. And then coming up, this is something that I'm excited about, that there's going to be Food Truck Fridays going on, mm-hmm. and they'll be happening down at the Railroad Street parking lot, mm-hmm. The parking lot between Farwell and Barstow. And that is planned for the first Friday of each month. Now, because the Friday for July was right after the 4th, they were planning on a different day for that. And that might be this Friday.
It's on the 13th last I saw.
Was it 13th?
They've moved it to the 13th, yeah.
So the 13th, and then after that August and September and October will be that first Friday of the month. So if you want to come down and have lunch downtown, certainly that'll be available.
What's the time for those?
11 o'clock till 8 o'clock. And right now they're planning, they're between 5 and 7 food trucks set up in that parking lot. And then we will have the U.S. National Coupe Championship on July 14th, and that'll be at our soccer park. So, then any questions on special events?
Okay, seeing none, we'll move to the director's report.
First item I'd like to talk about is the amazing Eau Claire cleanup. I do understand this happened back in May, but I think it's important last week because we had our meeting at an on-site location. Didn't have a chance to talk about this, but I wanted to really talk about is that we had 400 volunteers come out and help clean up our parks and plant trees and do things that, you know, make Eau Claire a better place to live. And I think that's important, that I just wanted to emphasize that. And then also our community service employees, our parks employees, were out there helping out in that cleanup. So I did have a number, and I don't want to misstate it, but we collected a lot of trash. we filled our garbage truck up pretty good with that, so I just wanted to mention that. Carson Park main playground was completed. We had the ribbon cutting ceremony on May 30th. I want to thank Meredith for coming out in the rain. We were planning to have a wonderful day there with the sun, and the day before when I was out there, there had to have been 300 kids out there playing, and then when we had this, it was raining. It was really raining. And so, but we did have a few people come out. It was very successful. It's a beautiful playground. If you ever get a chance to get out there, you'll be very impressed. Special surface, so kids, you know, we can get children that have handicaps, they can get out there and play. So it's all inclusive for all groups to come out and use that playground. So, and we didn't disturb the tube slide, so that's still there. So, Fairfax Pool, as you recall, back on Memorial Day, we had a very warm Memorial Day, probably almost unprecedented on how warm it was. We opened it up. We've already had over 11,000 people come to the pool so far this year, which we're hoping that we can break a record. And if the weather continues like this and the weekends are good, you know, we're on track to hit a record year. So
I have a question about Fairfax. Last weekend there was a swim meet. And,
yes.
Does that bring in like a different source of revenue?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Because it just seems like it was a really hot weekend. It was like, I talked to so many people, I'm like, I wish I could go to the pool.
Yeah.
We
have an agreement with the Y that does that. And we know that on that weekend we typically get quite a few complaints on our Facebook page.
Mm-hmm.
We didn't this year, so we're happy about that, but we try to make sure it's open for the rest of the year. So. Talk a little bit about our forestry division. We've talked about this a lot, about the Emerald Ash Board. We're continuing our efforts in regards to taking down the ash trees that we have, and as many as we can, and then treating as many as we can that are viable to treat. We still have about 5,400 ash trees within our boulevards and also our park areas. So knowing that the progression of this disease goes very quick in these ash trees, and then at a point when they do die off, they become very brittle and they become actually a safety hazard. So we're trying to get to it as much as we can. So what we have actually done, and I've talked about this before, is that we've cross-trained many of our other community service employees to assist our forestry, because we have 7 employees in our forestry division. That's pretty tough for 7 people to take trees down, and then once they're down, they have to grind out the stump, and then they have to do the restoration of the boulevard, and then someone's going to come back and replant another tree. So what we're looking at there is we're trying to create a more diverse urban forest. So we don't have anybody that was here in Eau Claire back when we had the Dutch Elm disease. Almost all of our boulevards were lined with elm trees, and when they died off, then all of a sudden all these beautifully manicured areas that had the nice shade trees on the streets were then barren, and we started all the small trees. So we're trying to do a much more diverse urban forest, so we don't get hit by one thing that's going to decimate our trees.
So I noticed that the city started tagging the ash trees with like little metal tags. Is there a way to know when those trees are scheduled to be taken down based on that?
Yes, you could contact our forester that would be able to help out. If you want to send me something, I can get you information if you have a location that you're interested in.
My parents just bought a house and they have ash trees. They're so sad, but I told them that they die anyway.
Well,
they're just curious. It's not a big deal. Yeah.
I think that ash trees help grow morels too. So.
Mm-hmm. Money.
I'm just.
In the spirit of eternal optimism, I've had my ash trees treated. Mm-hmm. I reported them to Todd,
yes.
So he can also figure out, because I think you're treating a group of them.
We are.
To see how it works. And I treated my boulevard trees just to see. So I know they're considered more at risk.
Yep.
Anyway, boulevard trees.
So yes, we're doing the same thing. We're doing some treeing, and with hope that they'll survive the emerald ash borer.
In the spirit of being a realist, we had our ash trees taken down. I think I talked about that before, but the truck came along with a variety. Had about 12 trees in the truck that had maybe 8 different varieties within those 12 trees, and I said, well, what do you want to do? And we put a couple of elm trees, and different variety of elm trees, and really great trees. So I think the city's doing a wonderful job in terms of attacking that and trying to restore a more diverse forest, city forest.
A little bit more on the park division. I've talked about this before, the goose roundup. That is something that we had planned on doing in June, except for we had a little bit of a problem with a lot of rain up in the upper watershed. Created a high level of water, so we actually put that off until July 10th. So we'll do a roundup at that time to collect up some geese and then try to manage the population a little bit for the city. You're wondering why we're doing that?
No, I said, what do you do with the geese then?
The geese actually are used for they're euthanized, and then they're fed to raptors that are being treated up north. I believe it's in Rhineland. So they're used as a food source.
A crematorium.
Some other things that we're doing. The DNR will be doing some mechanical harvest wheat collecting on Half Moon Lake. I don't know if you've been out to Half Moon Lake, but the water quality out there has improved greatly. We're seeing more and more activity in the water, people swimming. the triathlon came back, and they're actually, they used the Half Moon Lake for that. So in years past, they kind of steered away from it because the water quality was not what they would like to see. So it's to the point now that we're actually holding off on alum treatment for this year. Because we're not seeing that re-release of phosphorus from the sediments back into the water table. So, but we still have weeds and some of the emergence with the, especially with the curly leaf that comes up. We're trying to collect those before the turians. Those are the little seed pods, basically. If you ever step on one in the lake, you'll know what they are because they're really sharp. But we're trying to collect those before they actually they release those and get them off the lake. The turians are just like a seed, and they just then they replant themselves, and then they grow back up the next year.
Do we do any like just advertisement about that, about the lake being, I mean, clean? And I feel like there's just the stigma on Half Moon Lake, and people don't really, except for college students who don't know better anyway, you know. They just don't, a lot of people with kids might not go out there, and I don't know if there's a way to just let that be known. It's a safe water area.
Yeah, well, I mean, we do, you're talking about as far as utilizing the beach.
Yeah, sort of
the,
I'm just or like
public knowledge
just
about
like,
it.
Like an actual advertisement, like, come on out to Half Moon Beach, or maybe even, I don't know. It's just, I feel like people don't really think of it as a place to go.
Yeah, well, and I would agree, we probably, the river right now gets used more than the lake does. And I think one reason, because people like the tube, they have a destination, they take off from somewhere, and they end up somewhere. I think that is a big joy for kids right now, and that's what they do. But our plan is to revitalize that beach and bring it back to what it was when we were kids, and when we utilized it, and, you know, sliding down the slide into the water and things like that. So.
And we did have a meeting with Buzz Sorge from, he's retired from the DNR, but he's going to be working with us on an action plan for Half Moon Lake, and marketing, I think, is something that he mentioned too, that we need to do a better job on in terms of kind of maybe tooting our horn a little bit more in terms of some of the good things that we've done out there, so that the public does have a better perception of what's going on.
And that will be something that will be coming to this commission in the future, because we are, as Pat said, we're the Half Moon Lake Water Quality Report is being updated, so we can just, Pat said, toot our horn about how much improvement that we have seen since 2002 when the original report was developed. So it's been a success. I mean, a lot of times when you see with these oxbow lakes, you don't always see a success. They typically go into a point where they just fill in, to a point it becomes kind of like a wetland, you know. And typically in an oxbow lake like that, you don't have many deep spots just because it's a cutoff of the river channel that happened thousands of years ago before any of us were around. And so it's a success story, and we'll be bringing that to the commission here to review that once we're at that point. And then one more thing to talk about, Carson, a couple more things. We are redoing the concrete cap that goes around the baseball stadium. That's part of the, you know, structural framework. It had broken up in the past few years, so we're actually having that report. So it's going to be a brand new cap. And then also, when we lit up the lights this year down at Carson Park before the baseball season started, if you remember, we had almost a foot of snow at the end of April, so we didn't get going with baseball until almost the first part of May. When we checked the lights out, we had some bad wiring. We had all the poles rewired, with the exception of the one with the big Osprey nest on the top. So we couldn't get any volunteers to go out to do that. But once the chicks are out of the nest and everything, usually we get a chance to go up there. We usually put somebody up in a bucket truck and one person with a broom, the other person changes the light.
And a broom is sufficient to hold off.
I have pictures of that. That last time we did that, there was actually someone with the broom because they were doing some dive bombing on us.
I saw I can't even think of what I was reading, but a story where NSP had someplace had an osprey nest trying to nest on lights, and they built right next to it a box, you know, up on a big pole, because that's what they want. And then they were able to keep them from, I mean, I think it's really cool that they're up there, but I think, what is lightning like if you're an osprey chick? Maybe they're all traumatized. but I don't know if you ever considered, like, trying to give them an alternative.
Yeah, we probably have I suppose we'd have to find a spot for another pole up there in the outfield, but
never mind.
We were playing t-ball out there today, and that was a big distraction for the four-year-olds. They were all watching the bird.
Well, even in baseball games, when in between pitches, you watch the osprey come back with the fish, and people get fills in the. Seventh inning stretch. And then just a reminder, prime times, we're working on our fall winter prime times now, but the spring summer one is out there, so we're getting, you know, right now we've got we're actually getting record numbers of people applying for our program that we have in the city, so that's been good. So with that, any questions on the director's report?
Do I have the next page?
Is that the one about the
special events?
Oh, yeah. I got that kind of. Well, special events, we kind of went over that already. The last thing was the City Hall renovations. Next month, we will have our meeting here. But after that, because City Hall is going to be vacated, essentially, and we'll have a lot of contractors in here, we'll have our meetings from that point on over at Central Maintenance Facility. That's the big red building off of 4th Street, just to the north of the 4th Street Park area, where the community gardens are. So we'll set up our meetings there on a monthly basis. With hopes of, during this time of year, if we don't have anything that that needs any projection, we will try to do some of our meetings outdoors at some of our parks to look at some projects perhaps that we just finished that this group had some input on in recommending approval, or some future projects that we foresee coming to this commission. So it's nicer to do it this time of year than in the winter. So.
I got a request from someone asking about the canopy in Owen Park and how it's kind of grown down pretty low, so it makes it less accessible to walk through. I don't know if anyone else knows that issue a little better, but
you're talking about the tree canopy.
Yeah.
If you notice, we have opened up some vistas in Phoenix Park, or not in Phoenix, Owen Park. Oh, so yeah. As you get down the tree, we did open some up. We do want to try to keep it natural too, because if you lift everything up, then all of a sudden it looks like everything was lifted up and it's not as natural of an area, especially from the riverside.
Okay.
But we our plan along the rivers, and you'll see more of this as we go along, and it's actually part of our parks and open space plan and part of the comp plan too, is that we are attempting to open up more vistas. So open up an area, perhaps have benches in certain areas to where you can look out over the waterway. The water isn't only, a lot of people think you gotta have access to the water so I can touch it, but there's a lot of people that just want to look at it. So there's many ways of touching rather than being in directly into the water. So that's our goal as a department, is to try to open up some more of those.
Okay. Be curious to know if there's a lot of concern expressed to the city regarding our greatly expanded deer population, and I don't know if that, Bailey, if that topic is something this commission deals with, or we get the annual report from John Dunn on his deer count, but it just seems to me that it's exploding. And I know a couple of years ago there was a lot of concern, a lot of angst regarding people within the city, and it seems like John indicated, if I remember right, he said our deer population grew by 57%, if I remember right, from last year to this year, and yet is anybody complaining? And it's just my impression, I get the impression that there are just a lot more deer. As I'm driving around town, I just see deer much more frequently. So are we hearing anything, or is there any concern? Or Andrew, what?
It's weird because I haven't seen a lot of deer emails recently, but we...
I've been hearing concern.
Have you?
Mm-hmm. I heard from one person in the third ward that they had 12 deer in their backyard.
Huh.
Yeah.
But I remember getting emails a few years ago about it regularly, and I haven't seen any in my inbox. Unless people just start looking to me as a person who can solve it.
Could be that they're definitely feeling like they're
getting
used.
It's not working. Yeah.
They must be, the herds must be moving around. We, about 4 years ago, would almost every night, as soon as the crab apple tree produced crab apples, almost every night, at least 5 deer in the yard, and our yard is about as big as this table. So I opened the shades one morning a week ago, 1 deer in the yard, and that's all I've seen in a year and a half. Mm-hmm. So they're moving.
We haven't received any complaints, but the one thing that is what you typically see this year is that the yearlings from last year that were fawns are getting pushed off because the does are having new offspring. And you typically do see deer when there isn't food, when they're looking for food, because there isn't food in the woods at maybe at the end of the winter or in the early spring. But when there becomes more food available, then they go off and they find that natural vegetation that they can eat. So we have taken notice of what the population, what you need versus, you know, we were seeing a steady decline, and then all of a sudden last year, and I think what John was explaining was just probably perfect situations for him to identify deer this last year, where some years it wasn't, even the year before it was a very early spring. The deer are already spread out there, so he didn't catch them in the areas that he normally catches them. So I guess what we're going to do as a department is that we're going to continue to promote the hunting, the youth hunt. We're going to expand that out again this year. We have been doing it at the water plant. We're going to look out doing it over at the Northwest Community Park area. And then also maybe look at areas down in Mount Simon. Again, these will be controlled hunts, working with the Chippewa Valley Bow Hunters group. So again, just be bows. It won't be anything that will be a firearm or anything. The other alternative, if it gets to a point, is that you go to the next level of controlling your deer, and that becomes sharpshooters.
Can you repeat the places where the youth hunts would take place?
Well, right now it's at our well field, at the city well field. Again, we have 400 acres out there. It's very natural. In the past we've had a lot of deer out there. In fact, before we actually saw a decline out there, but now this last survey we saw it come back up again. The other areas that we're going to look at we haven't decided if we're going to expand out there, but it's the Northwest Community Park, which is off of Jeffers Road. And that's over 100 acres on that plot. It's a very mature forest, so it's not like the water plant where we've done selective cuts and some clear cutting where you get some of the saplings coming up and you get a higher density of deer out there. But during the year when you have acorns, because there's a lot of oaks out there, you can get a lot of deer out there because acorns are like candy to deer. They like that, so they'll go out of their way to try to find those. So. And then Mount Simon, along the lower part of the park, we've got some areas. That was another area that had a high density of deer that we found out. So.
But one of the most dense areas is the Third Ward. So, but that doesn't seem like a good location for any of these methods.
No, and that's why we really can't roam in that area. But because of the relaxation of some of the hunting rules for bow hunting, private property owners could get permission from their neighbors and they could hunt deer in that area if they're willing, but we can't go on private land and do that. So we have to look at the land we own, the public land, and take advantage of when we can.
Can you not go in Putnam Park because it's state land?
That's university.
I have friends who live in the Third Ward, and they complain to me, so I'm going to have them call Andrew.
Well, do they like that we have rivers and forests?
Yeah.
Because if they do, that's part of it.
Well,
if they want
I understand
concrete,
that, so I'm going to have them call you to have a nice, rational conversation.
I'll have a talk with them. I'll discuss it.
Has there been any discussion with the university about a potential hunt in Putnam Park?
They talk about it quite a bit at their meeting. They have a Putnam Park Commission,
yep.
And they talk about it.
But that would be something that would be widely advertised, I assume, if it were to happen.
Oh, sure.
Okay.
Absolutely. Yeah, and we advertise it when we do it. We make sure that we actually put take letters to all the surrounding landowners so they know what's going on. Because even in our ball field, we have a lot of people that walk out there and they have their dogs and things like that. So we want to make sure when they're out there, especially when we have younger children and handicapped children, that they're aware that what's going on. I mean, they're being chaperoned and everything is very safe. In fact, today, I think the last 2 years, 19 deer have been harvested mm-hmm. out at the well field. So, been very successful.
That's all. That would conclude the director's report for the month. Final item of business before adjournment and photos is recognition of Jason Duba. He is a departing member, and I believe that Jeff would like to present him.
Jason.
So, Jason, encloses a certificate of appreciation from the City Council for your service on the Waterways and Parks Commission. On behalf of the citizens of Eau Claire and the City Council, I want to thank you for your contributions to this board. Your participation has been valuable to the city and your dedication is sincerely appreciated. Again, thank you for your time, effort, and guidance to the work of the Waterways and Parks Commission. Sincerely, Dan Peter, City Manager.
Thank you very much.
And the certificate of appreciation presented to Jason Duba for dedication, service, and leadership on the Waterways and Parks Commission from 2016 to 2018, signed by Andrew Worthman, Vice President of City Council.
Terrific. Always. Thank you. I'd just like to say thank you for the opportunity to serve on the commission and to work with all of you. This has been a really great experience for me for the past 2.5 years. Learned a lot about how the city operates and the great people that serve the city as staff and elected officials and citizen members. And I've really come to have a greater sense of everything that goes into making our parks and forests and waterways so great. I mean, I've lived in a lot of places, and this is a special place, and my family and I are sad to be leaving for many reasons, but my wife got a job at the University of Dubuque, so we're moving to Dubuque, Iowa, and I also got a job there as a transportation analyst, so we're hoping to take what we've learned in Eau Claire and just keep serving wherever we go. And we have a 1.5-year-old daughter now. We moved here 4 years ago, so she was born in Eau Claire, and her middle name is Claire for the city and the river. And, so Phil always had that. And we live by Boyd Park, and so we go across the pedestrian bridge all the time, and I tell our kids is the Eau Claire River flows into the Chippewa, it flows into the Mississippi, and Dubuque is on the Mississippi River. So it's fun to think that your water here will be going by where we're going to be living, right down the river. Thank you.
We'll try and keep it coming.
Thank you, Jason, and best wishes to your move to Dubuque.
Thank you.
We will have photos after adjournment, so Leslie, is there a motion to adjourn?
All motion.
Is there a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed?
Okay. We're having fun.
But Jason doesn't want to leave. Okay, we are adjourned. And please stay around for a group photo.
This program was brought to you by a cooperation between NewsWorks and the City of Eau Claire. A transcript of this meeting is available for the hearing impaired. It will be available within 7 days of this telecast. Call 715-839-4912 or TDD 715-839-1689 or write Eau Claire City Clerk, P.O. Box 5148, Eau Claire, Wisconsin, 54702-5148. NewsWorks is made possible by continuing community support. If you would like to volunteer or make a donation, please contact us via phone at 715-839-5067 or online at valleymediaworks.org.